Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Words matter. In my earlier life, professors, I was a professor of writing. I taught my students to be careful and clear about what they put to paper. That is a lesson that the framers of our Constitution understood far better than anyone. They were laying the foundation for a new form of government, one that enshrines democratic principles and protects against those who would seek to undermine them. The Constitution explicitly lays out that a president may be impeached for treason, bribery, high crimes, and misdemeanors. We've heard a lot of words today: foreign interference, bribery, obstruction of justice. Professors, I'd like to go through the president's conduct and the public harms we have discussed today and ask if they would fit into what the forefathers contemplated when crafting those words of the impeachment clause. Professor Karlan, I'd like to ask you about the foreign interference in elections. As Americans, we can agree foreign interference, foreign influence erodes the integrity of our elections. And as you said so plainly, it makes us less free. Yet on July 25, 2019, the president coerced Ukrainian President Zelensky to announce an investigation into his political rival, Trump's political rival, which was corroborated by multiple witnesses throughout the Intelligence Committee hearings. Professor Karlan, can you explain for the American people, in your opinion, whether the framers considered solicitation of foreign interference, and would they have considered it a high crime or misdemeanor? And does the president's conduct rise to that level?
The framers of our Constitution would have considered it abhorrent, would have considered it the essence of a high crime or misdemeanor for a president to invite in foreign influence, either in deciding whether he will be reelected or deciding who his successor would be.
Thank you. Professor Feldman, I'd like to talk to you about bribery. During the course of the Intelligence Committee hearings, multiple witnesses gave sworn, unrebutted testimony that the president withheld nearly $400 million in congressionally approved aid on the condition that that Ukraine announce investigations into his chief political adversary. Professor, in your opinion, given those facts and the framers' specific concerns, would you describe the president's behavior here and the use of his public office for a private benefit as rising to those levels?
The framers considered, as you said, bribery to consist, bribery under the Constitution, to consist of the president abusing his office corruptly for personal gain. If this House determines, and if this committee determines, that the president was in fact seeking personal gain in seeking the investigations that he asked for, then that would constitute bribery under the Constitution.
Thank you. Professor Gerhardt, I'd like to ask you about obstruction of justice. The president has categorically refused to produce any documents responsive to congressional subpoenas, attacked and intimidated prospective and actual witnesses, including career and military and civil servants, as discussed here, like Ambassador Yovanovitch, Lieutenant Colonel Vidman, Ambassador Taylor, Jennifer Williams, and others. And he directed all current and former administration witnesses to defy congressional subpoenas. Professor, based on that set of facts, does this conduct meet the threshold for obstruction of justice as envisioned in the Constitution?
Yes, ma'am, I believe it does. I remember when I was here 21 years ago, along with Professor Turley, testifying before a differently constituted committee on a very serious question regarding impeachment. And I remember a number of law professors very eloquently talking about President Clinton's misconduct as an attack on the judicial system. And that's what you just described to me.
Thank you, and thank you, professors, all of you, all four of you. What you did today is you brought part of our Constitution to life, and I thank you for that. You've shown what the framers were mindful of when they wrote the impeachment clause of our Constitution. They chose their words, and their words matter. You know, it was my father, Bob Dean, a terrific dad and a talented writer, who instilled in me and my brothers and sister a love of language. He taught us our words matter. The truth matters. It's through that lens which I see all of the serious and somber things we're speaking about today: foreign interference, bribery, obstruction. The framers likely could not have imagined all three concerns embodied in a single leader, but they were concerned enough to craft the remedy, impeachment. The times have found us. I am prayerful for our president, for our country, for ourselves. May we, the people, always hold high the decency and promise and ambition of our founding, and of the words that matter and of the truth. With that, I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
The gentlelady yields back. Ms. McCarthy.